Talk of the Kernel MiniConf, and right now we've got Nick Desaulniers from Google, who will be talking about ClangBuilt Linux. What's next? Please welcome Nick, and we will have a live Q&A at the end. So again, please type your questions into the Tux Theatre chat, prefixed with all caps question, so that we can see it.
Great. Thank you so much, Andrew, and thank you for having me here today. Thanks to all the organizers. Possible kind of thing. You know, I would have really loved to be there in person. It's a conference. I always love watching the videos and the talks from, you know, unfortunately, I couldn't travel this year. I feel like I'm missing out on my, you know, yearly quota of drop bear jokes at my expense. But, you know, we shouldn't let COVID stop us. You know, let the drop bear jokes continue kind of thing. But anyways, really happy to be talking about a project that I've been working on and had the privilege to present a lot of the work that we've been doing over the past 2, 3, 4 years. I think we have over 100 contributors at this point. So you know, really lucky to be able to work with a large group of folks on these things. So just to recap, really, what did 2020 look like for us? You know, my friend Joel Stanley presented here at linux.conf.au in 2019. So it's been about 2 years since any updates on in this field. Really, 2020 was about, I think, CI, you know, there's this like football expression that really you need to have your blocking and tackling down before you can do any of the fancier plays. And really, in software engineering, I view continuous integration as your basic building blocks, your blocking and tackling, and what allows you to make aggressive changes and know that you haven't regressed or broken different things, right? So folks like Kernel CI, Tux Suite, Red Hat CKI, but also Intel Zero Day Bot, Linux Toolchain Working Group, Syscaller. You know, we had a lot of CI running up on Travis CI, and recently moved a lot of things to GitHub Actions as well. So having all this coverage and integrations of Clang builds of Linux kernels really gives us confidence in our builds. So previously, before 2020, Android and Chrome OS had both moved their Linux kernel builds to being built with Clang. And finally, in 2020, we were actually able to move all of Google's production servers in our fleet over to having their builds, kernel builds, be built with Clang as well. You know, a ton of work from a lot of people went into that. A compiler feature we implemented was called AsmGoTo with outputs, right? So a very interesting kernel feature using inline assembly, but transferring control flow back into C code. Had some limitations in the original design where very similar problem to calling functions or methods in C++ where maybe they would throw an exception so they could trigger control flow transfer, where you'd have this limitation where you almost like couldn't return values out of it, right? So if you had an ASM block with control flow back into C, you couldn't have any outputs kind of thing. And so this is something that we were able to kind of, I think, improve on the design a little bit about. And what was fun was actually I met Linus for the first time in 2020, and he was kind of like, oh, well, you know, I'd like to try Clang, but this is a feature I really want. And if you guys could implement it, you know, I'd give it a try. And what's funny is, you know, I knew he wanted this. We knew he wanted this feature. And so, you know, I went to this meeting holding pocket aces because, you know, one of my colleagues, Bill Wendling, had actually implemented this in LLVM because we knew Linus was interested in it. And so Linus was like, send me the patches, like show me how to build Clang. I will try it out kind of thing. And so, you know, I was very nervous for that meeting because, you know, I was nervous to see what would Linus think, you know, because I viewed it as he could say like, this isn't important. And then, you know, the whole effort would have been tanked kind of thing. And I think very luckily, you know, I think Linus saw some of the benefits to some of this work kind of thing. And it's been really nice seeing like pull requests getting shot down that introduce new warnings that are observed with Clang. It's been interesting to kind of see that and just some other discussions on the list and support and stuff. In 2020, so we actually shipped, we've been shipping LTO and Shadow Call Stack for a while, but 2020 was really, you know, LTO patches being sent upstream. I think they're still undergoing iteration. They'll probably land in 5.12. I think they're kind of accepted, but not merged into mainline quite yet for ARM64. And then for x86, there's a large patch set that got posted yesterday, fixing up, you know, a bunch of different warnings that Objtool finds. PGO patches, I just reviewed them last night, finally signed off on those. But those are shipping in Chrome OS. All these Chromebooks, the one I'm presenting on, will have PGO built kernels. LTOs used on Android, Shadow Call Stacks, a ROP channel, ROP attack prevention mechanism, AutoFDO. Sorry, I might be mixing these up. AutoFDO we're using on the Chromebooks. PGO we're using in the data centers. Very similar kind of mechanisms, taking profiling information and feeding them back. They'll probably all land in mainline in 2021, but 2020 is really when they all shipped, though LTO was technically a little sooner than that. We formed the Linux Toolchain's mailing list, which is a kind of a neat little space for folks interested in toolchain requests to kind of collaborate together on really what are the needs of the kernel community out of their toolchains. And then really we spent a lot of time on 2020 getting Clang's integrated assembler into shape in order to use it to assemble either inline assembly or out-of-line assembler files in the Linux kernel. So it's very difficult. It's a single-pass assembler. So, you know, it's inflexible, like C code, where you can't refer to things until you've seen them already. And it's a lot closer to it's a generated assembler kind of thing. So it's not as ad hoc. It's a little less flexible to kind of work with kind of thing. But a lot of work went into it in 2020. But the theme of the conference is what's next, right? So I really wanted to focus this talk on, you know, what do we want to do next for the project, and what are some like far-reaching goals, but things that I think we can either start or get done in 2021. So I think the main thing on my mind really is compile time performance, because I'd say Clang is not competitive when it comes to compile times. I don't think they're, you know, terribly bad, but it really depends on, you know, what kind of machine you're building on, you know, how painful it is kind of thing. And I think, you know, everyone would like to see improved compiler performance. Now, you know, I think in terms of link speed, LLD is the fastest linker you'll find. It will take advantage of multiple cores on your system and do so quite well. But I think there's a bit for Clang. So if you can imagine all the work that goes into a compilation job, what might you imagine would be a, you know, relatively slow part of compilation, right? So here's a perf profile I captured yesterday from Clang. This is from the entire invocation of make. So, you know, all the thousands of invocations of the compiler and assembler and linker and stuff. You know, these are the top level traces. And what's interesting in this trace to me is that these are things in the Clang namespace are all front end work. So lexing, parsing, you know, a lot of work keeping track of tokens and what files they're in for macros, but really not too much time spent in the back end. The only thing that really sticks out from the LLVM namespace is mostly some of the data structures, which are already like very extensively optimized kind of thing. You know, check ICE is integer constant expressions, expensive to check. So while I think we can visit individually optimizing each one of these, I have some pretty crazy ideas that I've been speaking with the front-end maintainer about, trying to bring ideas from the JavaScript world related to lazy parsing to the C and C++ world. Is, you know, could we lazy parse static inline functions or templates, not spend time kind of doing semantic analysis on dead code? And what's interesting is Chris Latner drops little hints at, you know, these kind of architectural changes to Clang at CGO was the latest one. If we had another IR in between Clang and LLVM IR, we might be able to kind of raise C and C++ specific optimizations back into that IR, cleaning up LLVM IR for other languages really, but also I think it might lead interesting compile time opportunities. But really, macro expansion is really hurting compile times with both toolchains. So Arne Bergman, a kernel developer, has, you know, interesting studies into this in some patches. And I think we can try to automate some of these cleanups, detangling some header dependencies and things like that. That'll really help compile times with both compilers. So, you know, we've had... you know, kind of ARM 64 and x86 are some of the main platforms that we kind of support. And, you know, things like RISC-V is, you know, on again, off again with support. But I think in 2021, we'll be able to add significantly more architectures. S390 is we're pretty much waiting on the latest version of QEMU to ship some fixes that were recently found and fixed by David Hildebrand at Red Hat, kind of thing. And we have some other fixes and stuff we'll need for some newer machines for inline ASM, but S390 is ready to go. Motorola 68K and C-Sky are newish backends in Clang and LLVM that I think we'll probably see those land in 2021 and potentially become actual production backends. So, I think as we improve our ISA compatibility story, it's interesting to see the kernel is actually kind of culling or removing support for some of the kind of longer tail architectures that really haven't been in production for quite some time. One of the things that I think is really cool, if you've heard of, there's a project from Facebook called Bolt that does kind of optimizations post-link. It takes kind of profile data and it ends up reordering basic blocks, which are kind of finer grain sub parts of your program, finer grain than a function. Basically, any sequence of statements before you have control flow is considered a basic block. And they're basically, their paper shows that we're leaving optimizations on the table by not reordering basic blocks based on how hot they are in a function. And so Propeller is kind of an LLVM equivalent that doesn't involve kind of blowing apart a binary and reordering it and reassembling it. But during the build time as like a linker optimization of doing this basic block relayout kind of thing. I think that's something that needs to be investigated in 2021. If you saw our talk at Linux Plumbers Conf this year, 2020, last year, there's a lot of work going into, can we use a safer language to implement drivers? And, I've loaded drivers written in Rust built from the core kernel, directly into my machine. And we have the binary compatibility. And I think this is, something that's a very interesting topic to a lot of people. So if you want to learn more about this, there's a mailing list and projects hosted on GitHub where you can see patches that are actively undergoing review from parties that are interested in. And they hope to put together a pull request, eventually to send to the mainline kernel. And I think we'll actually see that pull request go in 2021. Really cool idea. So Tom Ricks at Red Hat has been playing with this idea. Like we have this notion, like tree-wide patches in the kernel are kind of difficult of like timing-wise and stuff. But can we leverage Clang Tidy and its ability to automatically apply fixits to do tree-wide cleanups? It's kind of interesting. There's a lot of configs in the kernel. So when people ask, does this work with Clang? I'm always like, well, there's too many combinations to test. And I would be more comfortable if we had the hardware to test it on. So, but what's interesting is, some of these combinations, they don't build with any compiler, like code is still broken. So a lot to detangle, but I think focusing on distro configs is, what's important to people. That gets a little bit into how do you package LLVM for all these distributions? How do you improve the documentation for all these distros, right? I'm a big fan. I think Arch Linux has really great documentation for a lot of these things. I would love to write up like documentation for them on, how do you build kernels with Clang? How does that work? OpenMandriva, it looks like they were really close. Their 4.2 release that's, currently in release candidate mode will probably ship in 2021, very close. It seemed like to shipping in 2020, but for all the ISAs that we support, I think they're on track still to switch over to Clang built kernels. So that'll be super cool to see. And there's a lot more things in the LLVM ecosystem, I think really need more exploration. So there's the data flow sanitizer that no one's played with for the kernel. I think it will be really cool. There was a Google Summer of Code kind of research into using the thread locking annotations in the kernel. I think there's still more that needs to be done there in terms of, labeling precisely which variables certain like mutex or spin locks are protecting kind of thing. One of the things I think we should be doing more of to, help teach people how to contribute to Linux or how to contribute to LLVM is actually streaming some of the development work we do on Twitch. Getting new developers is something that's very important to me, right? It's like helping, push people into the pool and, teach them, explain, demonstrate, guide, and enable folks to contribute to the open source projects they love is something that's really important to me. But also, the next big step is once you have all these contributors, how do you get people paid and hired to work on this stuff full time is something that I think is a very tricky thing. I would love to try to, you know, help solve in some form, and maybe even participation in ISO standards body working group 14 for C. I think there's some things that need to get ironed out there, and, you know, constant discussion on a list of oddities of the language kind of thing that could really you know, be nailed down would help a lot of people. So if you want to learn more to get started, to learn how to contribute, check out our site, clangbuiltlinux.github.io. We're very active chat on Telegram, but we meet every 2 weeks. We have a public chat with folks from, you know, ARM and Red Hat and Linaro and Intel, and, you know, a bunch of folks will dial in and join in every 2 weeks. It's a lot of fun kind of thing. And we use GitHub for tracking all of the bugs that we've quashed and still have to quash. So that's everything for me. Thanks.
Thank you, Nick. We've got a few minutes for questions. So if you could please post questions in the chat, prefix them with question, and then we will go through them. The first question from Julian, you mentioned DFSAN. What about the various other LLVM hosted sanitizers?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so so TSAN is the only one that is a little bit on shaky ground. So I think TSAN kind of morphed into, I think it's called KCSAN, is a new form of, is like called kernel concurrency sanitizer. And so that's working well in helping folks on the kernel land. KASAN, KUBSAN are both in the kernel. I think the thing that's a little tricky that we have right now with the Clang implementations is they don't reuse stack slots, which is a compiler optimization where if you can determine the lifetime of local variables, you can reuse the stack slot for a function for variables with non-overlapping lifetime. And the Clang implementations will forcibly not reuse stack slots for the KASAN ones. And that leads to kind of excessive stack slot usage in the kernel, almost dangerously high. So I think that's something we still need to fix. But KASAN, KUBSAN, KCSAN, all ready to go. Try them out.
The next question from Clinton. I'm not familiar with lazy parsing at all. Is there a single sentence summary?
So the idea would be, let's say there's lots of static inline functions that are defined in headers because you don't want to have ODR violations, but you want to have code that's inlineable, inline friendly kind of thing. So you end up defining a whole bunch of functions in many, many headers and headers that include more headers. And then at the end of the day in your .c source file, you only end up referring to one of those, in which case you end up spending lots of time lexing and parsing and tokenizing all these functions, and then you don't end up using them. It's kind of wasted time for a compilation job. So the idea is you have a static inline function, you basically skip ahead in the token stream to the end of the definition if it's well formed, and then basically try to build a control flow graph, and you start iterating between traversing the control flow graph and actually parsing the body of the function. So you know, it's not free, it adds overhead in certain cases kind of thing, but basically we first need to do a bunch of statistics to see, you know, does my hypothesis hold, or, you know, is it hypothetical?
We are coming to the end of the time slot. So if you've got any further questions, head on over to the Kernel Miniconf Boff channel and ask them over there. Thank you very much, Nick, for your talk.
Great. Thank you so much, everyone. I appreciate it.
And we'll see you all.